Good morning, everyone. The Penn Law International Arbitration Association is delighted to welcome you all to Penn Law for our annual conference on international arbitration. The conference will commence immediately with its first panel entitled Women in International Arbitration. I will now leave the floor to the moderator of the panel, Ms. Carlson. Thank you.
Good morning. Thank you, everyone, for joining us for the bright and early Arbitral Women panel on women in arbitration. My name is Marin Carlson. I'm a partner at Sidley Austin in Washington, focused on investment treaty arbitration. And we are going to proceed on a fairly informal basis this morning, just introducing ourselves and our career paths, and then talking about a few issues of particular interest to women practicing in the field of international arbitration. But before we begin that, let me say a few words about Arbitral Women, which is one of the co-sponsors of this panel. Arbitral Women is a global group of women practitioners in international arbitration, focused on promoting women in international arbitration, but also promoting issues of interest to women in international arbitration. And that we should note that that interest is a broad one, because many of the issues that have been the focus of Arbitral Women's activity are also of particular interest to men in international arbitration. And so we're always glad to see an audience not only composed of women. So thank you, everyone, for being here this morning. Our panelists, and I am both moderator and panelist today, joining me here on the panel are Professor Susan Frank from American University. Next to her, Maryam Al-Rashid from Denton's. Then we have Professor Catherine Rogers from Penn State Law School. Then Danielle Morris from WilmerHale. And then Betsy Hellman from Skadden Arps. As I said, we thought we would begin by essentially introducing ourselves rather than go through the standard bio presentation. And so I think with that, I'll actually ask Betsy to begin and work our way back. And the thought was just to take three or five minutes to tell you how we came to this point in our careers in international arbitration. Sometimes it's not always a direct path from point A to point B. And to tell you a bit about our respective practices and careers. So Betsy, you want to kick us off?
Thank you, and good morning, everyone. So it was an interesting question, how did I get here? So I spent a couple minutes thinking about that yesterday, and I think it really goes back for me, at least when I was an undergrad. I had to do a senior thesis where I went to undergrad, and I did my senior thesis on the unification of the Humboldt University and the Free University, which were in East and West Berlin, respectively, at the time, and I used that as a microcosm for the reunification of Germany as a whole. And looking back on that, I think that was my first time of sort of telling a smaller story within the context of a bigger story, and vice versa. And that is essentially what I love about arbitration, right, is telling the smaller story as part of the bigger story, and the bigger story as part of the smaller story, and all of the history and politics and sociology and economics that surround the particular issue that you're dealing with your client. So my career has been perhaps a little unusual in that after law school I clerked and actually I summered at Skadden Arps, and then I clerked for 2 years and then I came back to Skadden Arps, and so I think that might actually make me a little unusual these days in that I have spent my entire career practicing at Skadden Arps. Our practice at Skadden, actually when I joined, the head of our group, John Gardner, who's the co-head, global co-head of international arbitration at Skadden, I, for the first couple of years, did international arbitration exclusively. And at some point he said, you know, you should sort of step out and dual track into general litigation. And I believe that was excellent advice. When you litigate in the United States, you learn how to take a deposition, you learn how to defend a deposition. You learn how to deal with massive amounts of discovery. You learn to learn where the bodies are buried. And those skills, I think, serve us incredibly well in arbitration, even though you hear that disclosure is so much more limited in the context of arbitration. I think it is tremendously valuable to have learned those skills in the context of litigation. And our practice in New York is somewhat different, perhaps, than some other law firms in that Our arbitration matters. If there is a litigation component, we don't hand them off to our litigators. We handle them ourselves. So we pride ourselves in our practice of being equally facile before judges and arbitrators. And quite frankly, that makes our practice very interesting and exciting.
Great. So good morning, everyone. I actually had no idea about international arbitration when I went through law school. I didn't even want to be a litigator when I graduated from law school. My dad is a litigator, and I thought that was a terrible lifestyle to have. So instead, I went to the State Department after clerking for a district court in Connecticut, and I ended up being assigned to the Office of International Claims and Investment Disputes in the Office of the Legal Advisor, where I worked on NAFTA claims defending the U.S. government. I assisted individual U.S. citizens with claims against foreign governments, and I also worked on arbitrations pending before the Iran-U.S. Claims Tribunal, and I had a blast. It was fascinating, even though I had a lot to learn about even where just to find documents, even when I had a citation for the documents, which was a new experience, but I had a terrific time, and I got a lot of great experience working for the government. And so in the Office of the Legal Advisor at the State Department, people rotate among different offices. And so when it came time for me to rotate, I realized that what I really wanted to do was to continue working on the kinds of arbitrations that I had been working on at the State Department. So I moved into private practice, first at Baker Botts in DC, working on investment arbitration, and then moving to Wilmer, where I've continued to work on investment arbitration and commercial arbitration involving sovereigns, as well as commercial arbitration more generally. So I'm a big proponent of starting in government before moving to private practice. You get a lot of great experience early on, and that's where I am today.
My name is Catherine Rogers. I teach at two schools, Penn State and Queen Mary in London. I actually also ended up in international arbitration quite by accident. I was due to start as a young associate after my clerkship and a backpacking trip in New York, and I showed up in New York with nothing pretty much except my backpack, and they said, well, instead of starting in New York, would you consider doing litigation in New York? Would you instead consider doing international arbitration in Hong Kong? And at that time, without admitting exactly how old I am, there was really no such thing as associates in international arbitration in foreign offices. It was really a very unusual thing. And I was young and perhaps more foolish than wise, but I did go. That was also how I developed my sub-interest in ethics and international arbitration. The short version of the story is that I worked for this unbelievably unethical man who ended up in jail on a client matter. Once you are, as a junior associate, scarred like that, you sort of tend to get very focused. So my scholarship really does focus primarily, not so much on the laws and doctrines and rules that govern international arbitration, but on the people. And the lens through which I look at them is ethics, kind of writ large. Ethics of arbitrators, ethics of counsel, and now also ethics of third-party funders. I do also, before I stop my introductory remarks, I think we're being webcast, and I think there are a number of Penn State students up in central Pennsylvania who are tuned into this, so I just wanted to say hello to them, and also excuse myself in advance that I'll be stepping out several times during the day because I have a couple classes I'm going to be teaching by AV while I'm here. So.
My name is Mary Mulrashid, and I'm a partner at Denton's in the New York, London, and Cairo offices of the law firm. So I spend most of my life on a plane. I did not get into international arbitration by accident, but I strategically positioned myself when I first started practicing law in order to get into the field of international arbitration. How I did that was I started in litigation. And I practiced for only 2 years. That's as long as I could last. I thought if I did it any longer, I might just die. And so I decided to do an LLM in international and comparative law at George Washington University. It was what I thought might be the shortest route to get my foot in the door in international arbitration. But I had also a sort of nagging interest in public international law, things to do with international criminal law, boundary dispute type work, which we see in international arbitration all the time nowadays, becoming more and more common to see disputes like that arise, but whether or not they're actually prosecuted or handled is a different question. When I did my LLM at GW, I kept pushing towards the notion of, oh, maybe public international law is really where I want to be. So I did my thesis on the illegalization of the privatization of Iraq under occupation. Now, that wasn't the title. I'm just, I can't remember the title, but it was about that topic. Through the course of doing that, I met a various number of people who worked for the Coalition Provisional Authority at the time and who worked for what they had then called the High Court in Iraq or the Special Tribunal in Iraq that was intending to prosecute Saddam Hussein. I say purportedly because it was obviously a court that was created under occupation, which is one of the issues. And through the course of that thesis, I realized that I'd probably find too many conflicts with my political opinions and personal issues, and then, of course, the job and what it would entail. So I thought, let me find something a little bit less controversial that I'd have to struggle with internally. International arbitration, of course, was still my interest, investment arbitration, commercial arbitration, so I decided to focus in that direction. Unfortunately, I finished my LLM and thesis right as the market was crashing in 2007, going into 2008, crashed in 2008, October, I believe. Through the course of my interviewing and networking to get into a law firm in practicing in international arbitration, I was strangely told by an individual who will not be named, of course, that the market's bad, and because it's bad, as a female young practitioner with no experience in international arbitration, and the focus was on female, I should probably step back and take a couple of years doing something else because it wasn't the time. It was going to be a lot harder for me than it would be for a male counterpart. And that just forced me to push so much harder to get into arbitration. And within maybe 3 months of that particular unpleasant conversation, I had gotten a job at Kroll and Mooring. A former colleague of mine will be on our panel, the next panel, Beju Vasani, and he was one of the individuals who sort of gave me my start. And from there, I worked myself up and became a partner at another law firm in London. I transferred offices from D.C., Kroll and Mooring, D.C., to London's office of Kroll and Mooring, and I was there for approximately, I would say, 7 years. After that, I started at a law firm called Pinsent Masons, and I don't know if anyone's familiar with that. It is a global firm, and it started from Masons, which they called the firm of rock lawyers or stone lawyers or something like that, because it was predominantly construction. I was the only female partner in the International Disputes Group amongst 128 partners. The firm was made up of 2,200 lawyers at the time that I was there, but in the 128 partners of our disputes group, I was the only female partner. So I found myself with these interesting situations every step of my career, but everything pushing me, I think, to try harder and, of course, prove whatever crazy notions people had wrong. And then I've ended up, of course, at Denton's as a partner, as I said, in three various offices, and I work with a wonderful group of people. And our primary goal in our international arbitration group is diversity on every level, and we have achieved it close to 50-50. And I'm on the diversity panel and work very hard with the firm to make sure that we achieve those goals. And so I would say my practice in international arbitration to me is as important as seeing the gender balance be maintained or bettered, if you will, in our area of law.
Great.
Hello, my name is Susan Frank. My story is a little bit of a combination of luck and a little bit of a combination of strategic choices. So when I was in law school, I was very interested in litigation, alternative dispute resolution, psychology, cross-cultural differences, and the like. But where the randomness came in was actually when I was a 2L at Skadden working in DC, I went to a cocktail party. And I kid you not, my life changed because of a purple pen. I had a purple pen with me, and Bill Sherman had a purple pen with him, and he was fresh off working at FERC, the Federal Energy Regulatory Commission, and he needed someone to help him with an international energy arbitration. For whatever reason, we hit it off, like, and it was like finding your best friend completely by random. And a lot of people in the firm, I learned later, were scared of him, but I just thought he was fabulous. So we worked on an arbitration case that summer, and I kind of fell in love because it was one of those places where I realized all the different aspects of my personality were able to find a home in one location. That's rare in life. And so when I had that professional epiphany, that's where the strategic choices started to come. So I actually asked my advisor in international economic law at Minnesota, Bob Hudek, what I should do. And one of the things that he said I should do was I should get a Fulbright grant to study international arbitration or comparative law. So I took that advice, but I also rejected that advice because he wanted me to do it in the Netherlands because he thought it would be easier. I said no. If I'm going to go for it, I'm going to go for it, and I actually chose to go to Queen Mary. And it was because of that access that I was given by my mentor in law school that I was able to make some of those choices. And once you start on the track, a series of other choices and options open up to you. So like I'm kind of bringing it all together. Skadden, Queen Mary, Wilmer, right? So I was actually able to meet Gary Bourne when I was a Fulbright student in London, and he encouraged me to apply to Wilmer, which basically meant I ended up at the Wilmer DC office for several years. And I was able to work on actually one of the very first contentious investment treaty cases, namely the Lauder versus Czech Republic case. And the reason that happened, once again, random and strategic, is I had this very bad habit of showing up to certain events late, where there was only one seat left at the table, literally. And that seat tended to be next to Lloyd Cutler, who was, of course, a named partner and the ultimate Washington insider, or that's what a lot of people called him. You never knew who was going to come out of his office. Carter, Kissinger, it was just, you literally never knew. But for whatever reason, he decided I was interesting. And I kept letting him know that I wanted to work on arbitration cases. I didn't stop. That was where the persistence came in. That was where the strategic element came in. And one day he said to me, how would you like to be a secretary on a tribunal? And that from there, everything really shifted. So it wasn't just that I had this experience as a 2L. I persisted. I educated myself in getting my LLM in arbitration at probably one of the best arbitration LLM programs in the world. Then I began to open up career channels by talking to people and honestly being authentic. Right? When I was myself, it showed, and they also knew then the quality of work that they were going to get from me. And from there, I ended up then getting dual qualified, believe it or not. So I'm actually a solicitor in England and Wales as well, which gave me the opportunity to move to Allen & Overy in London, where at the time I was the only US qualified litigator in the entire firm. That was interesting. It was also in the days of the, shall we say, Enron reassessment. But it was one of those opportunities that was too good to pass up. And during the course of that time, I realized that the things that I loved about law, the intellectual issues, some of the intricacies, and actually teaching as well, law firms and clients couldn't afford to pay for that, but a university could. And hence, I made my way into the Legal Academy, and I'm before you all today.
And so I didn't actually intend to go to law school. I'm a policy wonk at heart. I started off coming out of it as an undergrad, heading into an international relations master's program, and stopped off to see a friend who was starting her first year of law school, sat in on a couple of her classes and said, yeah, my mind actually sort of works this way. Why don't I add this in? Because I had spent time in Washington. All the people who had the jobs that I thought were fascinating all seemed to be trained as lawyers. They weren't necessarily practicing as lawyers, because that's Washington. But they were all trained as lawyers, so I figured, okay, let's put these two things together. So I got a joint degree, JD, and then a master's in public affairs at the Woodrow Wilson School at Princeton. and then set off to find a job in international economic policy. Now, you logically would think that the place to do that is in the U.S. government, if you're a U.S. citizen. And indeed, that's where I assumed I was headed. But I figured, okay, 2L summer, you should keep an open mind. So I will make sure that I spend my 2L summer at a law firm in order to make the informed decision that I'll, of course, never work at a law firm and go into government. And to my surprise, I found a practice where the focus was on international economic policy. It was sort of a new iteration at the time. What sort of was the idea of a new version of international law practice that was going to focus on truly international legal regimes, the WTO rules, international trade agreements, bilateral investment treaties, and explain to the private sector how those mechanisms could actually be used to solve market access problems, for example. And so I found this practice where I was actually making policy arguments in a private sector context. Never had any idea that such a thing existed. It's now much more common. But I have stayed with, after clerking for a year, I've stayed with that same practice group since a year after my law school graduation. So I think if you had polled my law school classmates as sort of among the least likely to still be a partner in a law firm some umpteen years later, I would be high on the list. But it is partly because I found the right niche. I've no longer really practiced international trade law. I do almost exclusively investment treaty arbitration, which is a hybrid of a public international law instrument with private international law interests all coming together in the same litigation space. And so for me, that was the perfect fit. It was a fit that actually didn't exist when I was in law school. I grew into the state practice as the practice itself grew to become a practice. But it just goes to show that you can't predict these things too much. So now you know who we are. And you've heard in a couple of our stories some sense of how the profession may have changed with us as we ourselves moved into it. I thought I'd start by asking Susan. Susan has the great reputation in the international arbitration space of being somebody who actually cares about the data. Lots of us like to go with our anecdotal examples, but Susan actually spends a lot of time thinking about empirical evidence to support a lot of what we all think is happening. So Susan, can you tell us something about the actual data on gender diversity?
I'd be happy to. Part of the reason I want to flag this is I said in my remarks that I was interested in psychology. And that was actually what led me to data. I've thought for a very long time about cognitive illusions and how they can potentially trick us into thinking things that aren't true, even with the best of intentions. And so this is one of the reasons why I want the data, because I want to know if I'm right or not. I have no ego in this. I very much want to know what the data say. So for me, the data in international arbitration basically set up a choice that the community, in my view, should be facing and addressing and grappling with. And that is whether or not the international arbitration community wishes to be a leader or a laggard in promoting diversity, whether it's gender diversity or other forms of diversity. And the reason I say that is because it's all about, I'm going to quote a song, it's all about the base. Right. It's all about the baseline. What are you comparing it to? Because if we're framing international arbitration and comparing it, for example, to national courts, international arbitration comparatively is not faring particularly well. To give you a sense of what's going on with national judiciaries, Canada about 33% are women, Venezuela 36%, Kenya 35.5%, Germany 40% are women, in the US about 33% in the federal judiciary, 29% in the state, Costa Rica about 35% of the women are judges. Right, so that's kind of some of what I would call the standard of judiciaries and gender representation. There are, of course, a few outliers. Japan, 15% of the women are judges. England and Wales, barely 21%, and that's rounded up and recent. Malawi, about 17% of the women, the judiciary are women. And the thing is, these issues are not necessarily confined just to who's in the judiciary. It's also issues about who's on corporate boards, what's going on in legislature as well, so we're not alone. In international arbitration, the highest number I've ever seen, and it came from a study that we did, is that 17% of our sample was women in a room full of arbitrators. And there were over 500 people in that room. So 17% is the high watermark. Usually it's around 9 to 12%, depending upon who's doing the research and what their case selection is. So you start to see, on one hand, you have a lot of countries with judiciaries, about one third, and we can't even get to the one quarter mark. Now, I want to compare that with what's happening more generally in public international law courts and tribunals. Because believe it or not, if our benchmark is public international tribunals, we're actually kind of about balance, because the international law, the C tribunal, only got its first woman like recently in the last couple of years. Most international, public international bodies don't have a lot of female representation. And the work of Nyanka Grossman is fantastic in this. She does a massive series of research pieces looking at, over time, the role of gender on courts and tribunals. The only outlier is the International Criminal Court, which has slightly more than 50% women, and that is also a function of the fact that the enabling legislation requires gender equity and gender balance in the tribunal composition. So in a way, our international arbitration is very much similar to what's going on in other courts and tribunals transnationally, right? But we are kind of behind if our baseline is national courts in most countries. So I want, for me, it's a very stark contrast of who do we want to be as a group of individuals.
And we've, I mean, that's just focusing on the decision makers. I think, going back to anecdotes, my own perception is that among the council ranks, women are doing quite well. But it does seem like that barrier to cross over to arbitrator is the sort of the glass ceiling that is a few women have broken through, but it feels like still a few. And that's what your data seems to.
Right.
To
and I think they're similar, but not necessarily quite as extreme stories as regards counsel as well. So there's another fantastic study that was done by Cecily Rose and Shashank Kumar. They were looking at the role that gender played in advocates before the International Court of Justice. And here's what's quite fascinating. 11% of the counsel advocating for the ICJ were women. In terms of repeat counsel, if you were only looking at the folks who were kind of at the bar, 6.3% of ICJ counsel were women. And one of the things that was interesting, which I actually think I've seen happen in domestic litigation as well, is if you wanted to make the crossover to being a woman who was active in ICJ litigation, it helped tremendously to be a government representative, namely somebody who was working directly with the state. So within the ICJ, for advisory proceedings, government officials and diplomats, gender representation shot up to nearly 20%.
But some of the projects focusing on arbitrators are interesting. I think I'd invite Catherine to chime in here, since you're involved in one of the most interesting ones we know.
Okay, well, thank you. So I think there are, it's nice to actually take as a jumping off point some of the points Susan made. One of the big problems is when you're trying to do empirical research in this field is it's all secret, right? We don't see the awards that come out. We don't even know what cases are pending. So if you actually want, so the statistics she cited was from a conference, a poll taken at a conference, okay? Well, that's in some ways a snapshot of sorts, but you can imagine it's not necessarily the most accurate, right? And we can't know how many women are actually sitting. So it not only because, but in addition, because of diversity issues or representation issues, which are a major concern right now in international arbitration, I've started a project to increase transparency in international arbitration, and particularly the name of the project is called Arbitrator Intelligence. The mission statement is to increase transparency, fairness, accountability, and diversity in arbitrator selection. And the idea is quite simple, is that there's a very strong correlation between lack of information and a number of other concerns that exist in international arbitration, including lack of diversity. So I'm going to start with a sort of hypothetical anecdote to sort of illustrate what that means. You have a woman who has just been appointed to her first couple arbitrations, and she was brilliant or someone, for example, from Africa, or someone from an underrepresented jurisdiction, because I think when we talk about diversity, you know, we are in a global context, and diversity doesn't just mean gender, and actually, impediments to gender diversity probably differ among different jurisdictions around the world. But this new arbitrator has been brilliant, just knocked it out of the park on the first, let's say, three arbitrations. How many people around the world know that? Okay, maybe 30, okay? And now how do you pick an arbitrator? So you make a sort of list of potential arbitrators, a couple databases, you might get a long list. Then you kind of shorten the list based on some criteria that are publicly available, okay? But how do you go from your short list to your pick, okay? You make phone calls. You send out an email, say, who's ever appeared before this person, who's worked with this person, okay? What are the chances in those emails that lead to phone calls that you're gonna happen to connect with someone who has sat with as an arbitrator or appeared before this new young arbitrator? Really, really low. So the fact that telephone calls to identify the most critical information in the arbitrator selection process is the methodology is I think a really big problem. So let me talk just briefly about the arbitrator market for services. So to become an arbitrator, there are what economists would call very high barriers to entry. The way you become an arbitrator is by sitting several times in previous arbitrations, okay? And the way you get appointed in an arbitration is by people knowing that you're a good arbitrator, usually through these phone calls, and appointing you. The problem I looked at was not only that there's not much information available, but it's not equally available. So if you are at Skadden or Sidley or Wilmer, and you need to check out some arbitrator whose name you have on your shortlist, you can get tons of information because you have lots of friends to call, okay? And you can get pretty detailed information that's treated as highly proprietary, okay? People exchange this through phone calls because it's, in a sense, a sort of insider's club. If you are a smaller firm in Africa, in Asia, in Latin America, okay, and you're in that same arbitration, and you make the same phone call about the same person, you end up with very different information because you don't have the network of people to call. And that is what we would call an information asymmetry. And I think that also creates a certain unfairness in the arbitrator selection process, which is one of the most critical moments in the international arbitration process. Composition of the tribunal, okay? So you have barriers to entry, you have information asymmetries, which I think contribute to the problems with diversity. So what's the solution? I think it is to, while preserving confidentiality, which is essential to international arbitration, it is creating a sort of layer of information that's more equally available to everyone. The solution I've come up with is what I call the Arbitrator Intelligence Questionnaire. It is a detailed questionnaire we're still in the process of developing. We just had public comment on it, got some terrific feedback. The questionnaire will be administered at the end of arbitrations. It's a little bit tricky. How do you get the questionnaire administered if you don't know the arbitrations are happening? We're going to be working with a number of arbitral institutions who will hopefully send out the questionnaire at the end. We're also going to take a page from Arbitral Women and try and do, we're going to call it, I think, a pact, an arbitrator intelligence pact, to get law firms and in-house counsel to commit at the end of arbitrations to fill out the questionnaire. And what we'll be doing is collecting all the data from this questionnaire. It's actually two phases. It's used to be available on our website. We'll be coming up with a new version that you can find soon. But the idea is we will take that data, we'll both make it generally available and also be engaging in analytics so you can do comparative analysis of arbitrators you're looking at. And the idea is that while preserving confidentiality, we don't ask the names of the parties or the counsel, we'll make a broad base of information about arbitrators available to everyone. So it will help make the playing field more even, and it will help younger arbitrators get their reputations more clearly established in a way that they can be evaluated fairly. We think that's an important way to try and grow the pool, and also, to be honest, create a whole lot more data for Susan to work with in the future.
Betsy, did you want to jump in on the subject of obstacles to arbitrator appointments?
Well, you know what, I think you made a reference just now to maybe taking a page from Arbitral Women, and I think maybe you were making a reference to the pledge. Mm-hmm. But so if everybody doesn't know about the pledge, it was something that was created essentially in 2015, and I think there are now, I checked online last night, 1,679 signatories to the pledge. And so I'm just gonna read a little part of it just so I don't misstate it, but essentially when you sign on to the pledge, you are saying, we are committed to improving the profile and representation of women in arbitration. In particular, we consider that women should be appointed as arbitrators on an equal opportunity basis. To achieve this, we will take the steps reasonably available to us, and we will encourage other participants in the arbitral process to do likewise. When I was thinking about this panel, I decided, when thinking about the pledge, I'll make a couple phone calls and I'll see, has this made a difference? Has the pledge made a difference? And so I'll give you two sort of, we'll make it off the record, but I put in some phone calls to two women at two leading international arbitral institutions. And first is mostly anecdotal. She said, yes, I do think it's made a difference. We always now make sure that a female is on every, when the institution is going to appoint, that a woman, there is at least one woman on each of the panel lists. And when we ourselves host conferences and things, we always make sure there's at least one woman on the panel. But it was mostly anecdotal like that we're trying.
I've been wondering whether Arbitral Women's next project is to do a follow-up on the pledge and say, so tell us what you've done to implement
exactly.
The pledge.
Exactly. So the next one is a little bit that this data is yet to be released, so it's a little bit in advance, which is why I won't name the institution. The news was that the institution has been keeping score, and 20%, when the institution appoints, 20% of the women, it appoints a woman 20% of the time. That's in the past year since the pledge has been in place. I believe the number of party-appointed females has fallen over the same period of time. And so the takeaway from that was the parties need to do better. The parties need to actually step in here. And so maybe Miriam, since you said you've achieved 50%, maybe you have some ideas as to how the parties can do better.
I wouldn't say I have a good idea. I have ideas, not that you said it's a good idea, but I'm going to start with an example and then move into what my idea is, and some will perceive it as very extreme. I was a party appointed arbitrator in an arbitration under the Organization of Islamic Cooperation Agreement on the Protection, Promotion, and Guarantee of Investments, APPGI. The Organization of Islamic Cooperation is composed of, I want to say 31, or I'm sure I'm overstating the number, Muslim countries across the globe. And they've all agreed to the APPGI and signed on to it. While I can't name the parties, this involved actually two states against one another, not a private party against a state. I was appointed by a North African state, and the opposing side was a Gulf state that functions under Sharia law. And so under Sharia law, until May 2016, which was the first time that a female judge was appointed as a judge in a courtroom, forget arbitrators. Sharia law does not allow a woman to be a judge, or for that matter, an arbitrator, or actually, I don't even think a mediator, if the last I read Sharia law. So the Gulf country objected vehemently against my appointment by the opposing side, the North African state. There ensued a debate, not with the Secretary General of the OIC, because they wanted nothing to do with any dispute that functions under that APPGI agreement, but the parties started to debate the issue, and we involved another institution. I think I can name the institution. We involved the ICC at the request that it was a very odd situation that that the Secretary General of the OIC was unwilling to cooperate and engage, and largely because they didn't want to promote this treaty. because the place where it is seated is a very powerful Gulf state, and that Gulf state does not want this treaty to succeed in the future, so they want to look at every way possible way to hinder the process for parties to bring a dispute under the treaty. So the ICC got involved and it was all sorted, and I remained, of course, party appointed by the North African state. Now, I use this as an example because we've now heard on the panel a number of exercises or projects that are underway to improve gender diversity for arbitrators, to see more female arbitrators, but also the issue still remains that there aren't enough female practitioners as well. They are not equal to the male practitioners. But put that aside and just focus on the arbitrators right now. We've seen these exercises, but we have an issue, which is diversity, and that's the next panel. Diversity of jurisdictions, and Sharia law in particular countries dictates certain things, so that is going to impact how these I keep calling them projects, but initiatives is the right word probably, how these initiatives will actually succeed. It's going to have an impact on that. So what's the idea? How can we make this work? Not every arbitration has an institution that appoints, doesn't have an appointing authority. So to the extent you can force parties to agree that at least one arbitrator must be a female arbitrator. Now, how do you get a party to agree that? We've seen rules change over time. We've seen the IBA rules, International Bar Association rules, change. Rules on evidence change and develop over time, and those aren't mandatory in every arbitration. They're often used as guidelines and agreed to as guidelines in the taking of evidence in an arbitration. But we've got to start to institutionalize rules for diversity, make evidentiary rules such as the IBA rules on evidence include something where the parties are forced, are required to include diversity, because there are statistics that show that diverse arbitration panels lead to, and this is not my words, there have been studies, lead to more just outcomes. Now, we can go into an entire psychological gender debate on why that is, but that's not what we're doing here right now. That's a very controversial issue to try to force parties to do it, because arbitration is party driven. And if a party doesn't want to appoint a female arbitrator, you're changing the whole fundamental landscape of what arbitration is, which is party driven. So that would be my start. And then I'd work backwards. I'd say that's where we start. Now let's figure out how to do it. It's controversial, but it's, to me, the only way, and it's the only way to get over the diversity of jurisdictions issue. And, you know, we've got to start somewhere, and maybe it means you have to start on the extreme end.
Sounds a little bit like some of the European requirements for boards,
right?
For gender.
Yeah.
So I want to make sure we have time for questions, but I also wanted to give Danielle a chance to weigh in if you want to throw in any experiences from, you know, the council side of the equation. I find that the hardest thing when you're thinking about counsel overcoming this barrier is risk aversion.
Yes.
Because your client, either the counsel or clients are both risk averse. But I don't know, have you overcome that in any cases?
Not yet, unfortunately, yeah. No, that's exactly right. When it comes time to appointing arbitrators, and this is exactly what I think Miriam is getting at, there is, on the one hand, yes, a commitment to diversity, and I think everybody, at least publicly, will admit that diversity is an admirable goal and one that we're working towards. But when it comes time to actually put together your list of arbitrators, you know, one of the top complaints is, I don't know that person, you know, from the partners who are making the decision. And then you have the added risk of going to your client and saying, we don't know this person very well, but we think that she would be a great fit for this case. And, you know, we have a commitment to diversity, so we think this is the way to go. You know, and the client is going to say, that's all well and good, but this is my money on the line, and I want you to find somebody that you can confidently tell me is going to produce an outcome that we anticipate will be favorable. And so there is, I think, without some sort of external pressure, it's much more difficult to try to convince a client, not sort of in the abstract, but with respect to their concrete matter, that it's worth sort of taking on the additional risk in order to promote a larger cause.
In connection with that, here's where we can take a lesson from issues of racial justice within the United States context, and particularly in the corporate context. Robert Gray, the former head of the American Bar Association, created a project called the Minority Corporate Council, the MCC. I encourage you all to Google it. And essentially the objective there was to essentially create internal pressure from within the clients within different areas of the sector so that everybody could make a commitment to hiring diverse lawyers and potentially, I would say, hiring diverse arbitrators. And so that group of corporate counsel have become incredibly influential in decision making. So there is some challenges when you have, an insensitive client in the sense that they can't hear data or they don't want to take a risk. But there are internal moves afoot. I think that this is a very fascinating project that Robert and his colleagues have engaged in. And these are pretty high-level corporations. I think some of them, what was it, General Mills. I mean, these are household names, folks who are involved in this initiative. So there are opportunities, but the grassroots take a while to grow.
All right, well, so let's open up to questions. I mean, we've focused on the issues, for example, of appointing women as arbitrators, but we're prepared to entertain questions of all sorts involving women in international arbitration. And while I'm at it also, I forgot to make one part of my plug for Arbitral Women that may be of particular interest to the students in the room, which is that Arbitral Women has a mentoring program. And then it also started a young women in arbitration group about a year, or I think a year and a half ago. And so I recommend those both to you if you're looking for networking opportunities. So, questions? Thoughts? We've had some provocative proposals. Yeah?
Investment versus commercial.
I wonder, I don't have evidence to back up, I wonder if investment treaty arbitration may have a somewhat of an easier path for women as counsel, because it is itself a newer space, right? It's not construction arbitration where there are people who've been doing it for 50 years. Because investment treaty arbitration has really only been happening for about 20. So
it's also worth mentioning, actually, that the two of the most frequently appointed arbitrators in investment arbitration are women, Gabrielle Kaufman-Kohler and
Brigitte
Stern. They're in some ways
the only ones.
Yes.
but in terms of the number of repeat appointments, yeah, they're really outliers. But they're also quite unique. And they're also different from each other, which is sort of interesting. So one dynamic in investment arbitration is there are sometimes individuals who are identified much more strongly with either a state orientation or an investor orientation. And Brigitte Stern clearly has that, state side persona. And that is in part why she's, I think, appointed quite often. Gabrielle Kaufman-Kohler, on the other hand, is quite distinct, is not so much associated with one side or the other, but has created a niche for herself, I think, being seen as a sort of arbitral chair. So she actually is the number one and she's actually been ranked on different metrics as the number one arbitrator in the world. And she, but she's sort of carved out a space for herself as being seen as this chairperson.
Although I think the hurdle, to appointments in investment treaty arbitration is much higher because there is no little case to start on.
Right. And they're also, they're also very unique, and there has, it's not like there are several others, right, you know,
right,
close behind them. They are real outliers. But it is interesting to note.
I'm going to say that I think there is quite a distinction in, I have no statistics to prove why this is or where my opinion comes from. But thinking about the psychology of the lawyers, the representatives, the counsels for either side, and the psychology of the clients. Investment arbitration, for the most part, is public. You're going to see, I say for the most part, it's not always. But commercial arbitration is mostly, if not all the time, private. And unfortunately, with investment arbitration, there is a need to present a picture to the public from both sides about who they're appointing, and they've got the best arbitration, arbitral tribunal. And the best means the people who are the most experienced with the biggest names. And those happen to be men who have been practicing for much longer than many of their female counterparts, as arbitrators, as presiding arbitrators, as co-arbitrators. So there is a hurdle there in that if you have a performing, if you will, client or a performing counsel on either side who really want to present a picture, you're going to see more of a hurdle to see women appointed, with the exception, of course, of, I would add Jean Kalicki to that, mm-hmm. most recently Jean Kalicki, Gabrielle Kaufman-Kohler, and Brigitte Stern. And there's going to be a couple more who are slowly growing in that rapport, in that group. Whereas commercial arbitration is private, and it's a little less high stakes. I say that generally. Of course, there are a few cases that are exceptions to that, and very high stakes in commercial arbitration. But you don't have the show and the whole game to present, look how big we are, that you would in investment arbitration. And for that reason, parties are a little less worried about appointing perhaps a female arbitrator who has a little less experience, but of course it's not such a high stakes that they're that concerned. So I think in that way there's quite a distinction between the two.
Yeah, and just two quick points. I think in investment arbitration generally, there are, you know, as people have said, very few women who have multiple appointments, but there are also, I think, a much smaller group of men who also get appointed, you know, umpteen times. So I think there's just sort of a smaller pool of repeat players generally. But because there are sort of fewer names that people are considering, I think there can be more of an opportunity for ICSID, for example, to make appointments. And I know ICSID itself has a strong commitment to diversity. So it may be that you end up seeing more diversity in ICSID investment arbitration sooner than in commercial arbitration as ICSID sort of steps up its efforts in this respect.
My name is Stanley. I came from Harvard Law School. So my question is in relation to the various initiatives which suggested that maybe we should require various arbitrary institutions, or maybe the IBA rules, or maybe the various soft laws, to require the various institutions, or maybe the parties, or even in-house counsel, to appoint women, or maybe to encourage diversity in all sense of the word. But I wanted to ask, so I understand that the basic tenets of arbitration or reason why people go for arbitration is because they believe that the parties will have the flexibility, you know, to dictate at least to a reasonable extent what would happen in the process. And already according to the Wire and Case and Quimeri various studies, already arbitration is no longer very speedy as people thought. It's already expensive, which is maybe one of the reasons, which are part of the reasons why people, you know, decided to go to leave a litigation to go with arbitration. So I'm foreseeing a pushback. The pushback I'm foreseeing is, won't parties say, oh, we are not going to be able to again be flexible enough in this process if you are going to tell us we have to appoint someone maybe from Africa if it's an African-related arbitration, or maybe you must appoint a woman. So how can we reconcile maybe this potential pushback and then again, protect arbitration so that most of us won't lose our jobs. Thank you.
I don't know where the balance lies.
That's a very good question. I'd start with saying that there's already a bit of outline rules. For instance, you take an ICSID arbitration and none of the arbitrators can be from any of the states or where, they can't be from the state that is the respondent in the dispute, and they cannot be from the state where the claimant resides or comes from or is incorporated. So there's already some outlines of rules where, you know, yes, international arbitration is meant to be party driven. It is meant to be flexible. It is not as cheap as people think it is, or has no longer become cheap. It is now just as expensive as litigation, perhaps slightly more. But that whole notion of flexibility still is true, with some exceptions, such as the one I just mentioned. To add one more component of saying, look, your tribunal needs to be diverse, not just diverse from jurisdictions, but gender diverse, is not such a big ask where clients or counsel will feel as if, oh, look, they're twisting our arm, we might as well go to court now, arbitration is just not as flexible as it used to be. In fact, what the whole notion of imposing one additional element to the diversity that we're looking at, right, not just jurisdictional diversity, but gender diversity, is only to improve upon arbitration, its elements, its advantages, and in fact, its flexibility, because the more diverse of a panel you have, the more diverse the thinking is, therefore the more flexible the notions are from the arbitrators, the way in which they interpret things. So really, you can make an argument that flexibility is only enhanced by that one additional element of diversity that might be imposed upon the parties. Again, I'd go back to the idea that perhaps you need to impose it on the institutions first, so that the parties don't feel as if they're being strong-armed by counsel. They understand that it's an institutional imposition and it's just one more. It's not a huge deal, really. It is advantageous. But you raise a good question, and it is something to think about, and the balance is hard to strike. But I would sort of put it in the way I just phrased it and hope that people can kind of understand that actually you're not taking flexibility away. You're in fact adding a bit more to it if people really took the time to think about it.
Yeah, I would add to that. I think, you know, I don't think it's a radical concept that if you broaden the pool of arbitrators, that you may well get back some of that speed, efficiency, cost, flexibility, right? So one of the complaints from a user perspective, from the council and from clients, is that investment arbitration in particular can be very slow. And that is because you have a very small pool of arbitrators that are hearing a lot of the same cases. And so I think it's well accepted that if you broaden the pool, you might, you know, free up some time and things might move quicker.
I do want to kind of push back a little bit, but also supplement. So Miriam had suggested that adding women or diversity to the panel might increase the quality of legal decision making, or at least potentially change it. In my research on looking at diversity in investment treaty arbitration, I found the presence of one woman, let alone two, but any woman on a tribunal did not actually change the substantive results of the case in terms of outcomes, relative success, etc. And one might say that's because the pool of women is so small that actually it's kind of the equivalent of statistical noise. But what I did see, and this goes to the efficiency point, is the p-value is 0.06, which technically is not significant, but essentially it is about as close as you can get to good. And what this meant was the inclusion of women on tribunals meant that the number of months it took to resolve cases was lower. So all male tribunals were taking longer to resolve cases, which theoretically is linked to cost. So if you potentially want to add a little bit of more efficiency and flexibility back into the practice, how do you sell it to your clients? Faster.
Interesting. All right, well, I don't want to run us out of time because I know that we have to get started and move on to the other panels. So I'd like to say thanks to everyone up here who joined us this morning, and thank you all for joining us as well. It was a real pleasure.